directly. For details, call 510-548-2220, extension 223, or visit ecologycenter.org. On Saturday, January 10th, from 10 a.m. to 5:30 p.m., the East Bay Meditation Center is hosting a day for peace activists. The day will include meditation, music, group discussion, and more. This free event takes place at 2147 Broadway in Oakland. For details, call 510-268-0696 or visit eastbaymeditation.org. On Saturday, January 10th, from 10 a.m. to 12 p.m., Garden for the Environment will host a workshop on urban composting. This event is free and is located at 7th Avenue and Lawton in San Francisco. Pre-registration required. For details, call 415-731-5627 or visit gardenfortheenvironment.org. The community calendar is produced by members of the First Voice Apprenticeship Program. Send your listing at least 3 weeks in advance to KPFA Box 51, 1929 Martin Luther King Jr. Way in Berkeley, California, 94704. Fax them to 510-848-3812 or email us at calendar@kpfa.org. Tell us if your event is wheelchair accessible. To hear this calendar again, call 510-848-6767, extension 621. This calendar is also online at kpfa.org.
Good evening, everyone. This is 94.1 KPFA in Berkeley, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and on the worldwide web at kpfa.org. It's 7:01. Stay tuned next for Full Circle.
Full Circle, yes, we rotate 360 degrees, ha ha, 360 degrees, ha ha, 360 degrees, ha ha, ha.
Good evening, everyone. This is Free Will in Franklin. This is Full Circle. This is your community radio magazine, and it's our first show of the new year. And tonight we're going to bring you a special show by two graduates of the First Voice Apprenticeship Program, Gil Cho and Antonio Ortiz. Two personal friends of mine, also mentors. They mentored me in my apprenticeship time. And they're using the skills they acquired in the apprenticeship program to produce a series about modern technology. The series will air on the Radio Chronicles, heard Sundays at 6:30 p.m. They received a grant from the Paul Robeson Foundation to create the series they call the Digital Chronicles. That's coming up. Also, as you may or may not know, Full Circle is a show produced, hosted, and engineered by current and graduate apprentices. If you, too, are interested in learning media skills, at the end of the show tonight, there'll be an update about our recent application process. So all those people who want to put application in, you still got time. So keep your ears on for that later. So on tonight's show, Antonio Ortiz will bring us a feature about electronic waste recycling. Be sure to check that out. That's coming up first. And then Gil Cho will bring us, Gil Cho will bring us a piece on how two people became accidental techies at their job. And finally, at the end of the show, we'll speak with the award-winning musicians from Ghana, VIP, Vision in Progress. They have a show tonight right down the street from here, and they're going to be here to talk about that. So stay tuned for Full Circle. All right. Still Franklin here. How y'all doing tonight? Before we begin our technical journey tonight, we want to let you all know about a benefit that's happening, or that's being held for First Voice graduate Nadra Foster. If you all remember, Nadra Foster was arrested for alleged trespassing. I don't know how that could happen since she's a community member, but for alleged trespassing on the KPFA premises August 20th, 2008, and she's facing criminal charges. This benefit will help raise funds for her legal defense. It'll be held on Thursday, January 22nd at La Peña Cultural Center, 350 Shattuck Avenue in Berkeley. It starts at 7 p.m. and costs $15 to $30 sliding scale. And like we said, the proceeds will go to helping her legal defense. To learn more about this situation, you can go to blockreportradio.com. And that's from JR from the Block Report. He's got a lot of information on the Block Report about that. So let's get into our first piece here. Like most of us, you may wonder what happens to all that electronic waste we generate, like cell phones, computer monitors. I'm sure we all have it laying around. personally, when I always throw it away, I'm concerned of where's it going to go. Or a lot of times, in my case, it might be an old TV. How much does that cost to throw away? It's like $50 to dump in my house. So, like I said, where does it all go? Well, coming up in our first piece, Antonio Ortiz will answer these questions and more as he teaches us where it all goes and how to properly dispose of our e-waste.
I've always wanted to know what happens to our electronics once it reaches the end of its life. Where does it go? And a better question is, where should it go? We have a very interesting relationship with electronics. It seems we're always looking for the newest gadget, the newest computer, the newest phone, the newest everything. But what happens to the computer monitor that is left on the sidewalk with the sign, "Free, still works," when it hasn't been picked up? Isn't this electronic waste hazardous?
Well, all of these things are not destructive as long as they're kept in their original containers, right? I mean, they get harmful when they get broken. CRTs have lead in them, but the lead's not going to come out unless the tube gets broken.
There's a lot of really poison chemical on the precious metal and the metals. They are there to protect us from the X-ray, from the TV and so on and so forth. So they do serve a functional purpose, but they have to be properly managed and manufactured in a protected environment. Well, actually, all electronics can be recycled. The question is that what's the price you're willing to pay? There's an effort to take apart the monitor, the TV, the cell phone, your toasters, your microwave. Everything can be dismantled.
When I think of electronic waste, I think of yuck. It pollutes the environment. It's a waste of resources. Things that are made today should be recycled.
Electronic waste is ridiculous. We're just going deeper and deeper and heavier into the darkness where we don't want to go. We need to go towards sustainability.
You know, I really am not up to date, to be quite honest, on what society is doing at this time regarding what we do with our e-waste.
I mean, I think most of it gets shipped off to, like, developing countries, and it's not good. But luckily, I think there's, like, more recycling programs now in places that'll pick up your waste and get rid of it. But, I mean, it's not something I think about that often.
For me, I think it's just an issue that people don't really think about that much. I know myself day to day when it comes to, you know, recycling and all. Electronic recycling isn't something that pops right up in your mind, which probably makes it a bigger problem, because if people aren't thinking about it, a lot of times people probably just toss it in the trash or whatever and don't take care of it.
So what do I think about electronic waste?
You know, I didn't know anything about it since I don't know what's inside those machines that we use. I have no idea. I just use them. In fact, I'm lucky if I learn to use them. So when I started to read it maybe about 6-7 years ago about places in China where these things are sent and they're toxic inside and people are breaking them down and everything, it was horrifying, and I thought, Well, I was really, really happy to find, not far from my house in the East Bay, the Alameda County Computer Resource Center. And so I felt like I bring it to them. They say they recycle it. I hope they do. That's it. Because I don't know how to live without my electronics. I don't know. The whole world's living with electronics, and I feel bad that they're made like that. And I hope that they're made differently. And I hope that nobody's getting toxified.
I feel guilty throwing anything plastic in the trash, so I can't imagine throwing a monitor away. Where should this stuff go? I recently went to the Alameda County Computer Resource Center to know what happens to electronic waste when it is recycled properly. I followed Aaron Mollering to see what he does and how he prevents this stuff from going to landfills, or even worse, going to a third world country where it is dismantled in a way that is not only hazardous to the environment, but also hazardous to the workers doing the dismantling.
Well, our number one goal is to reuse computers. You know, you'd think to make a profit means, well, I'll take the high-end Pentium 4s and sell them. That's not what we do, though. We take the highest-end computers and we give them away. We give away as many of those as we can. We sell the low-end scrap.
The ACCRC will take any type of electronics, and when I went to their warehouse in Berkeley, near the I-80 freeway, Aaron Mullering, the warehouse manager, gave me a tour and showed me some of the things that were recently collected.
And this box seems to have an old radio. It has lots of keyboards and mice, joysticks, speakers, power supplies, zip drives, floppy drives, CD drives, game pads, all kinds of stuff that doesn't stack well on a pallet. Wires of all sort, all kinds of different wires, VGA cables, power cables, DVI cables, USB cables, parallel cables, all kinds of cables. Then we have the non-electrical equipment, six things, cardboard, paper, ink, metal, plastic, and styrofoam.
Yeah.
Pallet is a 42 inches by 48 inches square prop to put materials on, used for loading with forklift or pallet jack. Pallet jack for short trips and forklift to load it onto a truck. I find that most people that come to recycle with us is they come because we reuse things. I mean, people become very attached to their equipment. They don't want to get rid of it. They've had this thing for 20 years and it's served them so well that they don't want to just throw it away, you know, and they hear that we give it away, give it a purpose, have somebody else use it, and so they bring it to us. And I find that most people bring it to us for that reason.
Aaron has worked with the ACCRC for 7 years. He tells me how he got started recycling e-waste and why he enjoys doing this type of work.
I started coming in and working in the tech department, programming computers and getting ready for placement. After a few weeks, the warehouse manager had a very large mess in the warehouse that we... so he needed a lot of help. You know, he mainly survived on volunteers at that time. And so he'd pull us out into the warehouse and we'd work very physically hard, and we'd go, I'll want to go back to the tech room. No, let me go back to the tech room. But but eventually, you know, I really started to enjoy the physical aspect of the work and the fact that we're actually clearing up a large area, and what it really amounts to, like my job now, is basically to get stuff in the building and get it out of the building while being environmentally correct and making as much money off it as we can, you know. And so that was my job, is to figure out, you know, what sort of materials I have, what am I dealing with, you know, styrofoam, paper, computers, you know, all the different materials I have, and how can I get rid of this stuff while maintaining an environmental profile. So all these pellets, right now I'm looking at about 20 pellets of CRTs. These are getting ready to go to ECS in Santa Clara. As soon as we get 24 pellets, we call the truck. Truck comes, picks it up. And all the information we originally logged is on the pallet itself. So then when it goes out, we have an outgoing list of weights, outgoing weights. So we track it from its incoming weight to its outgoing weight. Keep track of all that stuff for the government.
Reuse is actually the best form of recycling. And our company do a lot of collection, but we do about close to 1-2% of the recycled item come through our center. We do condition them. So reuse is definitely something that we actually strongly encourage, and we also do some of it. And the reason why our percentage, though, is that because we limited ourselves to do it in the U.S. We're worried about the secondhand dumping. Had we opened it up to other developing country, there's a lot of equipment which is deemed obsolete here functionally can still be extended for another 2 years or 3 years. But we are concerned about the second life dumping problem.
That was the voice of James Cao, founder and CEO of Green Citizen. Green Citizen has recycling centers in San Francisco and Los Altos. He shed some light on why electronic waste is such a big problem.
It's a big problem because computer and technologies are produced without thinking about how they're going to be recycled properly today. When electronics is not properly dismantled in a protected environment, that's to the worker and to the environment, it will cause birth defect, nerve disorder, as well as kidney failure, lung failure. And one very easy example is lead. We have banned lead from paint long time ago. And for each of the monitors, there's 48 pounds of lead in the old TV and the computer monitors. When lead is not processed and collected properly, it leaches into the water. So the environmental consequence is huge. What we found very encouraging is that people quickly understand it's not just simply waste of resource. It's actually there's a health consequence for doing recycling the wrong way.
Some computers that no longer have use in this country can still get shipped to other nations where they can be used for a few more years. However, James tells me why it is not a good idea to send computers to other nations and why it's important to properly dismantle them here.
The problem with sending equipment to third world country is not that they can they use it. Some of them can use the equipment. The problem is in lack of regulation, lack of awareness, and lack of enforcement. And what we do is we track all the items down to the brand name and serial ID. We treat the e-waste as evidence of recycling. We don't treat it just a piece of nameless e-waste. And by tracking them down to the model number and serial ID, we can best work with our manufacturer partners to take apart all these items in the state of California. State of California has one of the most advanced environmental protection law. They have very good regulation and oversight for all the business which are approved to operate in the California. The facility will require random checking of, you know, blood sample of worker to make sure there's no leaching of toxic into the workers, as well as air sample in the facility to make sure there's no leaching in there. And those are absolutely necessary. It does cost a little bit of money, but that's only the right thing to do.
So I feel the less that we can use, like reduce usage, so we can reduce waste.
I think about the precious metals that are involved in electronic waste. It's really important to recycle it, and you can actually help save the earth from being extracted for more precious metals by recycling it.
I recently read the book Cradle to Cradle, and the basic premise of the book is how recycling isn't good enough. What really needs to happen is something like a step before that, and what the authors suggest is designing with reuse in mind. It will eliminate a lot of the problems that we're facing. I mean, an electronic waste is one example of that. It's not just, are we recycling well? It's more like, are we designing well?
We're already used to innovations. The new device is not only cheaper, it has better functionality, it has better reception. So it's difficult to hold consumer back, a business back, when they can have that kind of productivity improvement on that. What we do need to get to is the thinking from cradle to grave to cradle to cradle. A lot of product today is developed and manufactured under a severe time constraint, you know, and so they don't think about what happened to that piece of equipment at the end of its life. So a lot of things is like throwaway, a concept where the machine, while it's very functional, is very difficult to take it apart. So as a result, a lot of material needs to be crushed down and go for the lowest common denominator, so which is not good for the environment. We need to break that cycle and go into cradle to cradle. What do I mean by cradle to cradle? Is that what if that your iPhone 2, every component in that iPhone 2 can be reused or recycled, crash down to become a raw material, and you can make iPhone 3 or iPhone 4 out of it. Then we're not continuing digging into the earth for the ore to mine to make another iPhone. And that's the cradle-to-cradle cycle when you're created to.
To learn more about what you can do to properly dispose of electronic waste, check out the Alameda County Computer Resource Center at www.acccrc.org or Green Citizen at www.greencitizen.com. That's one word. They both take your electronics and properly dispose of them. And who knows, if it still has some use left, they'll refurbish it and donate it to organizations and individuals who can use it. For Digital Chronicles, I'm Antonio Ortiz.
On the oceans and upon our seas, fish full of mercury. Oh, oh, mercy, mercy, mercy. All things ain't what they used to be. Lost now. Radiation underground and in the sky. Animals and birds who live nearby all the night. All things and what they used to be. What about this overcrowded land? How much more do you demand? Can't you stand?
Mercy Me, that's the one and only Marvin Gaye. And before that, we just heard a piece by Antonio Ortiz on e-waste recycling. And look forward to Antonio to bring you more stories about electronics, maybe some more electronic waste recycling. Who knows? He's working on a series with Gil Cho. And this is Full Circle. This is KPFA 94.1. I am your lone host tonight, Free Will and Franklin. And we're exploring our technical side tonight with the Digital Chronicles. It's a series of shows to be produced by graduates of the apprenticeship program, Gil Cho and Antonio Ortiz. Up next, Gil is going to bring us her piece as she talks with two women who find out you don't have to be a super being to conquer the computer world. These women that she interviews start off in one direction at their job, only to find themselves drawn, perhaps accidentally, to the realm of IT or information technology.
When it's time for adventure, it's time for Superman. Richard Pryor and Christopher Reeve in Superman 3. This time, Richard Pryor has come to Metropolis, and he's got something to sell. He's the world's greatest computer genius.
Let me tell you something.
But then he falls for a scheme to turn the ultimate computer into the ultimate weapon. A machine so powerful.
Baby, it's Daddy!
It can control the Earth.
Now, getting down to business.
Change the weather.
Now something. You're a genius.
And reprogram Superman.
Well, I hope you don't expect me to save you, because I don't do that anymore.
Computers rule the world today, and the fellow that can fool the computer can rule the world himself. I've been searching for a long time for somebody to make these machines do what they're not supposed to do. You get my drift?
This is Digital Chronicles. I'm Gil Cho. What we just played you was a trailer for Superman 3, which came out in the early 1980s. 1983 might seem like the technological stone age by today's standards, but the reality is that it was probably one of the most pivotal years for personal computers. Microsoft Windows had just been introduced, Time magazine named the personal computer the machine of the year, ARPANET had just standardized TCP/IP, which is essentially how we talk on the internet. But even so, Superman 3's plot of down on his luck Richard Pryor joining forces with an evil conglomerate to take over the world through computer hacking probably seemed pretty fantastical even back then. What's crazy is that the plot of Superman 3, which seemed so fantastical back in the 1980s, could actually pass for realism now. Computer networks are compromised all the time. Self-aware computers don't seem far off. And as evidence from the current financial crisis, corporations programming a free market by brute force is not stranger than fiction. In any case, whether fantasy then or reality now, if you can't tell from the trailer, Superman 3 was a pretty terrible movie even by 1983 schlocky standards. Having watched this movie as a kid 25 years ago, the only thing that stayed with me, aside from the cheesy special effects, was Richard Pryor's character, Gus Gorman. Gus is just trying to find work in Metropolis. He's actually standing in the unemployment line when, unwittingly, he sees an advertisement for a computer school on a matchbook cover and decides that he's sick of working menial jobs and goes and takes a computer class. He finds that he has a knack for computers, hacks a few databases, reprograms a satellite or two, builds a supercomputer to bring down Superman, etc., etc. But by the end of the movie, despite this extraordinary turn of events, Gus ultimately was someone who wanted a better opportunity for himself. We watch as Gus embraces the technology for the opportunities it provides, but then the technology goes horribly wrong, and he realizes the hidden costs of all of it. Throughout the movie, you get a feeling that Gus knows computers well, but he's ambivalent about technology and what it can do. Gus is us. He's not Steve Jobs or Bill Gates, but like most of us who interact or work with computers, he stumbled into his job in IT. Because the economy and culture changed, jobs in IT were born and people had to fill them. Essentially, we're ordinary folks caught up in extraordinarily technological times. Terry McGinnis is the executive director of Lion Martin Health Services in San Francisco. The other voice you'll hear in this documentary is that of Sue Bennett, a consultant at Compass Point Technologies. Bennett has written the book Accidental Techie, Supporting, Managing, and Maximizing Your Nonprofit's Technology, which was written to support the Gus Gormans of the world. We present our first documentary, The Woman Who Knew Too Much, about computers.
I was the person who realized that when the computer wasn't working, you should restart it. Poof, you're an IT person.
An accidental techie actually has two definitions from our thought about it, and that is either somebody who has the role by accident, so they didn't take a job in a nonprofit as a technologist. They took a job perhaps as a development director and started needing help with their database, or they're the receptionist and they're being asked to answer questions about how to do certain things.
When I left my YMCA job, I had managed the entire facility and all of the fundraising and all of the membership and all of the marketing, and couldn't figure out which one thing I wanted to be when I grew up, and I decided it was fundraising, and there was a fund development assistant job, and I applied for that, and I thought I was just going to do fundraising.
Or it's somebody who took a job intentionally to do technology, but hasn't had any formal training. So oftentimes in nonprofits, you know, we are asked to do jobs that are outside our job description.
So, Terry, why don't you just, in your own words, tell us about your organization?
I know, I thought I was talking about me.
We are, but I need some backup info in case, like, we go into that.
Lion Martin provides healthcare for people who have no place else to go. We provide healthcare for people who feel like providers in other places ask them questions that are inappropriate to their lifestyle. We have been nationally recognized now as a transgender healthcare provider organization because one of our providers is a volunteer transgender doctor who has written a book about transgender healthcare.
A lot of intentional techies come into the nonprofit world thinking technology is technology, technology, right? Like Outlook works the same whether you're selling a widget or serving people. But the people involved are going to be very different, and the intention of the folks involved can be different. I also think a lot of equipment is donated in nonprofits. You know, your brother or your, you know, somebody's company is getting rid of stuff that's not that old. So it ends up in the organization, and so you have to deal with those kind of issues, whereas a for-profit enterprise would never, you know, be getting three-year-old computers and, you know, thinking they were really lucky. And folks who worked in for-profit sector aren't aware of those issues at all. So the book talks about some of those cultural differences, you know, the organization not having technology in their management focus at all. Oftentimes, if it's at the management level, it's, you know, stuck under the finance director or the operations director, somebody who takes care of the brick and mortar and the whole organization. But then technology has very unique challenges that that person might not have any idea how to deal with.
How old are you, Terry?
Is that relevant?
I'm 37.
Sometimes the youngest person in the office, whoever's had the most experience with technology in other jobs or other environments.
About 6 months into my job and the computer went down and everybody panicked and I just said, let's restart it and see what happens.
Do you know how they actually dealt with stuff like that before you got there, or did they have a consultant come in? Or
I believe that there was a person who knew a person who knew a person who knew something about IT, and that person would call their, you know, their 7 degrees of separation friend who would come in one day every 6 months and try to figure things out. But when I was there, there were offices that had computers that didn't work.
Yeah, I think the when we talk about technology, people instantly go to the wires and the hardware and the systems. And really what we found working with community-based nonprofits is that it's just like any other piece of management in an organization. And that is, it's about people, it's about users, it's about training, it's about knowledge, it's about fitting the systems to the organization. And so bringing up the capacity of the organization overall is much more important than, you know, what brand of computer or what speed of computer we're going to buy.
Que será, será.
The part of me that likes to fix things loves it when it works right. And when somebody can say, hey, I can't get onto the network, and then I go to their computer and I do something, never knowing really what it is, and then have that work is great because I love to fix things. I still am in that place where I don't know what I want to be when I grow up, and so having the opportunity to have learned how to fix some IT things sort of opens a whole new field for me. And so it has been very enjoyable.
I asked my mother, what will I be?
I don't know, when you're saying that, you know, you don't know what you want to be when you grow up, are you actually thinking about that possibly as a career trajectory?
It certainly provides the ability to solve a problem and move on, which is something I really like to do. I like a project that gets finished and you move on to the next project. I like a project that get something done for somebody, and then they can do their work more efficiently. And so in that respect, it's really exciting to me to have that be part of my job. You know, but I also love the finance stuff that I do. And I think for me, it's all the same thing. It's all seeing the problem that's either right in front of you right now and fixing it, or figuring out the solution to solve that problem that might be a mile down the road or a year down the road. So I think for me, because I take that skill set with me, I think I want to apply it to IT. I don't know whether I'll ever be able to do it as a full-time, go to school, learn how to do it officially and get credentialed and all that. Or not.
To me. Que será, será, whatever will be.
be. The future's not ours to see. Que sera, sera. What will be. Second verse.
When I was just a child in school, I asked my teacher, what should I try?
I grew up on a farm and watching, you know, my grandfather, you know, rebuild the tractor and build a barn and build a house for the family to live in. And, you know, that was my great-grandfather and great aunts and uncles. And, you know, watching my grandfather do similar things on a small scale when we moved into the city.
We'll be, we'll be.
You know, and then being a paramedic is sort of like that same thing. You find a person who needs your help and you fix them and you take them to the hospital and they get better. Or maybe that's not the outcome, but it's kind of always what I've done.
So folks like that tend to, you know, want to know enough to get the job done. And this is the other thing I stress, is just really know enough so that you can have an intelligent conversation with the people you hire to help you. I think so many of us are intimidated by tech support from the outside or by consultants. So if you understand those systems enough to ask the right questions, it's really valuable.
It's definitely frustrating when the person on the other end of the phone is short or terse or irritated that I'm using the wrong words. But I always start my calls by saying, I'm the IT person on site, but that happened to me by accident. And I know, I usually say to them, I know just enough to be dangerous, but not enough to do the right thing. And so that either makes them laugh or makes them angry because, you know, then they think, why can't I talk to the real IT person? So it is hard. It is frustrating. And I do try to, you know, break that barrier with a little bit of humor right up front, saying, I really don't know what I'm doing, but I need you to help me. And sometimes that works and sometimes it doesn't. So what do you find to be the hardest thing about being an accidental techie? I think I know enough to be dangerous, but not enough to be helpful sometimes. And because I'm sometimes not afraid to try things, things might go wrong. And just that fear of losing everything, like pushing a button and losing everything.
How do you do that?
Like everything else in the 20th century, Gus, you push buttons.
I do think it's an opportunity for learning anytime you have a failure. Again, I think that's what the accidental techie can bring to an organization, is a decision about, well, how much time does it make sense for me to have my learning process about this? You know, when is the person from the outside that's expensive, but ultimately going to cost us less because they're going to know the answer within the first few minutes of seeing the problem, whereas it might take me a few days to even figure out what the problem is. And the accidental techies are, I don't think we'll ever be free of a consultant at all, because there's nobody in the world that knows everything there is to know about computers. I can be the whiz techie of the universe and I'm still going to have to ask for help. But the accidental techie can help figure out when it makes sense to go outside and when to do it internally.
Ladies and gentlemen, the famous Miss Doris Day has gladly consented to sing a few songs for us tonight.
Que sera, sera. Whatever will be. The future's not ours to see. Que sera, sera.
You're right, that was a gunshot you heard. That was the signal that brought all the trouble out in the open. It's a scene from our new picture, The Man Who Knew Too Much. As you know...
And luckily, I've only ever done one very terrible thing to a computer.
Okay, now you have to tell us about that. What happened?
We were transitioning from everybody having their email in different platforms, and there was a person who had her email on some internet-based platform, and we're trying to move her to Outlook. And I had copied her, I can't remember what it was in, I should remember because it was very traumatic, but I had copied it two or three times in two or three different places, all of her emails and contacts and all of her, you know, history of her email. And when I stupidly deleted the program from the computer, all of those files went away. And so I couldn't then transfer it to Outlook. So the person who had been working at the organization for the longest period of time now had none of her emails and none of her contacts.
How did the end user react to you?
She was very graceful about it. And, you know, I cried. I was so upset that I cried. I was like, I have to tell you this very bad thing happened. And I was so just, I felt so bad. And she was just very gracious about it. And ironically enough, when I went on vacation last year, and I had just asked a fellow employee to open my Outlook every day, not every day, once a week, so that my emails would download because we were doing off-site web hosting, she deleted all of my Outlook stuff. So it actually, a few years later, ended up happening to me.
Wow. So I guess, I don't know, it comes back.
It does.
But I can't imagine you actually crying.
I cried.
You cried at work, or you just...
Oh, I cried at work in front of her.
Wow.
Oh, yeah.
Wish we had that on tape.
Just kidding.
Are you crying?
No.
Are you crying? Are you crying? There's no crying. There's no crying in baseball.
Why don't you leave her alone, Jimmy?
Oh, you zip it, Doris. Because there's no crying in baseball. There's no crying in baseball. No crying.
So remember, while there's no crying in baseball, there is crying in IT. But while tragic events or acts of God are a pretty common thing when it comes to technology in the workplace, one thing that isn't so common is someone like Terry actually being the techie. What do I mean? I mean that women in tech are scarce. Women play minor roles in many high-tech occupations. For instance, women make up only 5% of computer programmers, 10% of systems analysts. Additionally, women lead only 5-6% of major high-tech companies in Silicon Valley. It's pervasive. Not unlike what Sue said earlier, it's the culture of technology that we have to reckon with. But with the absence of resources, nonprofits actually offer a chance for not only accidental techies, but women to step up to the plate.
Nonprofits tend to be predominantly female staffed, so there's a higher percentage of female staff to start with. So I think overall, if you went to a nonprofit IT gathering, it would be predominantly male. But the percentage of women in the job would be higher than your for-profit technology conference.
They ask me how I knew my true love was true. I, of course, replied, something here inside.
Any funny things that have happened to you?
One time, right after we had purchased our new computers, there was this emergency page over the phone system at the clinic, and I had just walked from my office to the clinic side, and I was being paged to come back to my office, and I came back and there was smoke coming out of the monitor, and apparently what I had missed was sparks flying from the monitor up into the air, and then so all I got to see was the smoke, but that was the most exciting thing.
Your eyes.
We sent that one back.
So I chaff them and I gaily laugh to think they could doubt my love. Yet today my love has flown away. I am without my
To learn more about Lion Martin Health Services, you can go to lion-martin.org. To purchase a copy of the book, go to fieldstonealliance.org.
When a lovely flame dies, smoke gets in your eyes. So I chaff them and I gaily laughed to think
doubt my love.
All right. Welcome back, everyone. This is Free Will in Franklin. That was Black Sabbath, Computer God, and that was our show. That was our pieces about digital, the Digital Chronicles by Antonio Ortiz and Gil Cho. They're going to be doing a series about digital experiences, technological advances, so keep your eyes peeled for that. But now we've got a special guest in the house, Nioble, a.k.a. Ross Nee. He's a former apprentice graduate, and he's brought some guests tonight. So how you doing?
I'm good.
He's brought some guests tonight from
Ghana.
From Ghana.
That's right.
And it's VIP, hip-hop artist from Ghana. Tell me, how you doing?
I'm good. I'm pretty good.
And we also have... go ahead.
I'm here because of KPFA, the opportunity KPFA gave me, you know. That is the apprenticeship program.
So all right.
That made me get this far.
And he's also brought with him Eli Jacobs. He's like a promoter, manager, documentarian, he was saying.
That's me.
Tell us about your boys right here, VIP.
So... VIP, that's Vision and Progress. And we got a film about their whole life, 10 years growing up in Ghana, what it was like back then to become international superstars now. We got a big event tonight at the Shattuck Down Low. That's right here in Berkeley. And tomorrow we have the movie that I produce and directed. It's called Homegrown Hip Life in Ghana. And that's at the intersection for the arts. There's going to be two screenings. That's tomorrow on January 3rd. The matinee is at 3 p.m. and the evening event is at 8 p.m. So check out hiplifemovie.com for more info on that. And we got a lot of people in the studio, man.
All right. Someone step up to the other mic up here. Introduce you stepping up here.
Yeah. What's up, yo? My name is Lazy and I represent VIP all the way from Ghana, baby.
What's up, Ashiv? I'm from Boogie Down Nima.
That's right.
Yeah, we got some more.
Yo, what up? It's your boy 9NYC, straight from the X, man. BDNAENT.
Yo, what's up, man? It's your boy Prodigal, the man with the Ten Commandments voice right here in the Bay.
I'd say, yeah, this is that voice, man. Right on. So we got about 10 minutes here. We're going to have to do a little plug for the apprenticeship program. Let me know. We got a CD here. What track you want to check out? You want to go straight to that?
Yeah, this is the international hit right here. I won't. Big up to Los Racas. They playing. VIP's playing tonight. Nana NYC. DJ Ladies is going down. Shattuck Down Low. Check out the music, baby.
I'm dope. It's on in about 2 hours.
Baby, Awum is going down. Shattuck Down Low tonight. VIP's in the building.
That's right.
Yeah, VIP.
So my brothers and sisters, wherever you are, make sure you come out tonight because it's going to be a good show. We have everybody, you know, we have a couple of artist from New York. My man NYC is right here with us. And my man Ross is right here. Ross Nees representing with us in the Bay Area. You know what I mean? So make sure you show up. This show is going to be a good one. And my man Eli got the movie going on tomorrow. Just come support what we have.
We're calling out all the Liberians. We're calling Liberians, Sierra Leone, Nigeria, all of you.
You are, come on. YouTubers, man. YouTubers.
YouTube VIP. African,
tell us, where at from Ghana are y'all from?
Yo, we from Accra.
Accra, Nima.
Accra, Nima. Yo, we need worldwide music listeners to come to the show and witness what we have, because, we travel all the way from Accra, Ghana, to cross rivers to come over here. And
cross oceans. That's prodigal. Ocean, prodigal, the Ten Commandment voice. Tell us what time the show is tonight.
Yo, so it's nothing for you driving, 5 minutes or 10 minutes from your house to come and witness what we have from Africa.
The time of the show.
The show starts from 7, 8 o'clock. Just from now. So just start going there now. Start going there now.
It's going to get cracking by 10 o'clock. By 11 o'clock, performers on stage, come through, man. DJ Rosny, DJ Ladies, Los Rakas, Vision in Progress, live from Ghana.
BDN.
The Bay Area in the house.
ENT.
Yo, if you don't know about Ghana, let me tell you a little something about where we're coming from. You know about Kofi Annan, right? The former UN Secretary General. That's his hometown. Witness where we're coming from.
Kwame Nkrumah.
Kwame Nkrumah, man. Azuma Nelson.
The boxer. Joshua Clotho just beat Zab Judah for the title. So we saw that match. He's from Ghana too.
All right, the flag is red, gold, green, black star in between.
Remember that. Let's tell us another track we can go check out real quick. We got a couple more minutes, then we'll get one more track in.
Let's check out Besson. That's number 8.
Besson. Come on.
Give him some. Let's give him some.
Who names say Uwaha Hills? Besson. Who names Sokuta Night Fingernails?
Besson.
Who names say Udo Viapia?
Besson.
Y'all names say Obebia Boss? Jessica, Rebecca, Monica, when you go with dinner, I say,
So we just had a little acapella, all right. So we'll check out the original track off the CD, and we'll be right back. Tell you a little bit about the apprenticeship program. One more time, that's VIP tonight at Shattuck Download.
It's starting now. Get dressed and get down there, baby. Right on Shattuck Avenue, Berkeley, California. Thank you, KPFA. We love you.
All right, we'll be right back.
Apprenticeship program representing.
VIP. We're saving the last few minutes for that. Last few minutes. I got it. Look at his partner, man. Welcome back. This is Free Will and Franklin. Sorry about that little mic check earlier. I had my mic on. But that's Besson by VIP. They're going to be at the Shattuck Download tonight. And I'm also joined in the studio who brought VIP to us tonight. Rosny, a.k.a. Rosny. How you doing?
Right. I'm good.
So like I said, you're a former apprentice. And right now the apprenticeship program is accepting applications for new apprentices. Tell me what it was like for you to be an apprentice.
It was great. It was more than great, I could say, because it gave me an opportunity. You don't see that many Africans getting an opportunity around here. But KPFA embraced me, taught me what I know right now. Right now, I'm DJing. I'm promoting shows. I've been able to bring VIP all the way from Accra. First time in the Bay. This is all from KPFA experience. Where you're sitting right now, that's where I used to be. So anybody want to join the program is the greatest ever. We don't discriminate. Anybody can come in here.
And that's right. And I want just to let you know that you can get it at firstvoicemap.org. That's firstvoicemap.org. You can download an application there. And we have not set a new deadline yet, but there's a big holiday run around. You know, at the end of the year, we had graduation, we had holidays, we had all kinds of stuff happening here at the station. And we know people cannot always get their applications in on time. So we want to encourage people to still fill out those applications. You can go to firstvoicemap.org. You can also call 510-848-6767, extension 235. Get on the phone with someone, have one mailed to you. Or you can also stop by the station, 1929 Martin Luther King Jr. Way. And that's in Berkeley, California. And the business hours are 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. Monday through Friday, starting next Monday. So one more time, tell me what it meant for you to be an apprentice and how that's helped you in your skills that you developed, how it's helping you now and what you're doing.
Like I said, what I really, really appreciate is the organization part. It's a very intensive program which you really have to dedicate some time in order to be able to acquire the knowledge to be out there on the field. So I've been able to organize shows, promote events in my community, all because I learned from, you know, KPFA. That's the skills I learned and I've gained and I've been able to use it in my life. So it's good.
So you'd recommend it, definitely recommend it.
I recommend
it.
Anybody. You know, I'm going to give out to all the Africans out there. You're welcome to come by to the studio and, you know, represent your community, wherever
yes,
you're
yes.
from.
And that's what we're all into. We're into representing the community. And this program emphasizes providing opportunities for women and people of color.
That's right.
So once again, this is Full Circle. Earlier we just heard the sounds of VIP. That's them in the background. And they'll be having a show tonight at the Shattuck Down Low. It's starting any time right now, so you go down to Down Low, check them out. They'll be on later tonight.
9 o'clock.
9 o'clock, so make sure you go out and check them out.
Right on.
And also download your application, firstvoicemap.org. Become an apprentice. Be on this side of the mic. Bring your friends, your community, and let them be heard.
Right on. We want to hear a different voice. I want to give a shout-out to all the former apprentices, all the graduates, Regita, Dana, Pema, Kiva, all the rest, Waylon, everybody else. Peace.
All right, thank you.
Right on. What's going on, man? I'm about to start the show.
All right. That brings us to the end of tonight's show. I want to give special thanks to our production and technical interns, Golda, Angela, Laura, Gloria, Carl, Melody. Our executive producers are Ranjita Giesler and Miss M. Our technical director is me, Freewillin Franklin. If you have any questions or topics for future shows, give us a call, 510-848-6767, extension 627, or send an email to fullcircle@kpfa.org. With me, myself, Freewillin Franklin, holding down the controls, I have been your host. And thanks for joining us tonight on Full Circle. Make sure you get out to the Shattuck Down Low. Check out VIP all the way from Ghana. All right. Take it easy. Stay tuned next for La Onda Bajita.